The seventh module is devoted to a discourse on forest and wildlife law. The law concerning the forest and wildlife is antecedent to the biodiversity law, which we discussed in the previous module. The difference between the two is, while the biodiversity law was the direct result of our international commitments through an international treaty arrangement, forest and wildlife law have a colonial backdrop to it. It was evolved basically as part of a natural resource management legal regime during the British period, survived for a pretty long period of time, even after our independence, without much change, and the changes that came about have been fairly recent. So it will be interesting to see a legal order concerning the greener aspect of the environment, which passes through different legal regimes, having both colonial content and independent spirit imbued in this body of law. We will first start with the forest law. And in discussing the forest law and the policy in relation to that, we need have to really familiarize ourselves with as to why a law was planned and put into application with regard to forests over a period of time, right from the British to the present day. In terms of perceptions, forests have been considered as one of the basic resources for economic development, meeting industrial demands. The timber and other resources that are available in the forest. And in addition, one of the very peculiar features of forests is underneath the surface, you find plenty of mineral deposits in forests are characterized by the presence of mineral wealth as well. So here we have an ecosystem which is full of wealth, both above ground and below ground. And so it is going to be something which will be eyed by every developmental motivated government to make use of this resource to the maximum hilt. Mega projects of multi-purpose kind have come into existence in the forest, even leading to the destruction of forest and things like that. And so one perspective is, from the economic angle, forests are important. The second major dimension of viewing forest is from the ecological angle. It is something which is full of life, brimming with life. And conservation of life is an integral aspect of forestry. And the kind of service that forests would render, both visible and invisible, which are referred to as ecosystem services, they are the natural carbon sinks, they are the source of rivers and water bodies, and take away the forest, these would get affected seriously. And so this has very great ecological significance. And forests, since time immemorial, have been the source of sustenance and survival for a large community of people who have been living within the forest or in the close vicinity of the forest in India. It is a source of livelihood, it is a source of shelter for a large number of people. So how much of all these dimensions of perceptions find place in the policy and get accommodated in the law is the subject matter of an inquiry now. In terms of the policy, if you view the position before the British came to India, forests were considered as a seat of learning and an abode of outlaws. Really a contradiction. Yes, It was a seat of learning because all learned sages and seers lived there, had their ashrams there, gurukuls, and to these places the people from the cities, the civilized part of the state, including the royalty, would send a tutor for education and higher learning. So this was the place of higher learning. In tranquil atmosphere, amid silver surroundings, it was a place for great enlightenment. It's also another story that it was also one which was populated by wild animals and also outlaws, those who were not behaving in a civilized manner as in a civil society should, were banished and they were made outlaws and put into the forest. So it's a very interesting mix of being a seat of learning and an abode of outlaws. But by and large, forests were considered as a common property of the communities of people who lived in and around this area, and the state hardly interfered in the activities within the forest area. It was left alone. So state had a minimal interference there. This changed with the coming of the British. During the colonial period of the British Empire in India, the forests were viewed as a very great economic resource, as a primary state property. And so, as a state property, the state wanted to exercise control, and so it started coming with its policies and laws to exercise its eminent domain over them. And they used the public purpose as the basis upon which the state could take control over them. And it imbibed a Western notion of management of forests, wherein the state would have an exclusive control and those who lived there just because the state allowed them. If the state did not feel like allowing them, they had to go out of it. They did not have any claim, right, entitlement or ownership or anything there. So the state exercising control and authority over the forest is something that we got through the British rule in India. Even the state did not stop at the forests that were there in the public domain, even those that were under the exclusive private control, they were private forests. Certain people did take a liking for maintaining and managing forests all by themselves on their property. And even the state started looking into those properties as well. And so the rights and entitlements of the people and communities were got restricted because of the state intervention, control and management, something that was customarily enjoyed by a large number of people. So as you see the evolution of the policy, the British came up with a forest policy way back in 1894, and much later, when we became independent, we came up with our own independent India's forest policy document in the year 1952. But by and large, the 1952 policy document of independent India followed the same footsteps of the British, of considering people as those who are permitted, given some license, to be there in the forest and make use of the forest resource, and without state authorizing them, they had no claims over that. That kind of an attitude of viewing forest apart from people, and not people and forest as having a symbiotic relationship, was not something that was considered a normal thing in the British rule. And this found reflection in both the policy and the law document. People had reduced interest and privileges with regard to the forest over time. The state started coming up with a number of measures of not only restricting people's claim over these, but there were certain times when the state, bound by certain populist sentiments, started allowing people to have some access, a limited access, some entitlement, Some write in relation to them, more as a grant, more as a concession over a period of time. Even after we became independent, the same practice continued. Limited access, limited use, and limited management at the discretion of the state is essentially the main feature of the policy and law in relation to forest till around the year 1988 in India. It's only in 1988 when a new forest policy came, bringing and integrating people in forest management and also recognizing their rights, their traditional wisdom, and putting those traditional native wisdom into application of the forest area was given a new thrust only after 1988 with this new forest policy that we had in independent India. And so, the basic idea, as you could see, of the state-centric approach to forest management is quite at variance with what we developed under the constitutional scheme. The Constitution of Independent India is something which views resources, the people, and the government differently, of considering the government as a public trustee, the resources belonging to the people of India, and so engaging, involving people in some form or the other in access to, use, management, and even control over resources with the constitution commands and even contemplates was not very much reflected and continues to be not reflected in major part of the forest law that is in operation in India. There are a few exceptions to this, but it is not in the forest area till around the 1980 development. Let us just, with this as the background of a policy pronouncement and a policy bias as to how the forests are to be maintained and managed. Initially, forests were part of the Ministry of Agriculture. It's only in the year 1980, forests were made part of Environmental Administration. And so with the result that the dense influence, both in the making of the forest law and the policy of the agriculture department, is very clearly evident. Now, let's have a quick look at the Indian Forest Act of 1927. The law that was made during the British period and the law that has been brought into application and continued to be in operation even long after our independence. This is the major framework law concerning forests in India. Each state can make their own laws, but that has to come within the frame of the Indian Forest Act of 1927. An act having 13 chapters and 86 sections. Deliberately, forests are not defined under this law so as to give enough liberty for the state to decide on when, how, and what manner they need to decide on what should be a forest area in the state. The forests are created and are classified on the basis of different kinds of utility, value, significance, and also the nature and extent of access and entitlement the people will have in relation to the forests. The second thing is that forests are under the exclusive control of the state, and both in the creation and the declaration of any area as a forest, it follows the same pattern of the land acquisition law. So under the land acquisition law, the procedure is very similar to what you have here as well. Much of the earlier part of the Indian Forest Act, in each and every category of the forest area, be it the reserve forest or the village forest or the protected forest, it comes to a notification, first of an intention of acquisition, and then later grievance redressal, and then much later the state settling of the claims in relation to that piece of land or whatever the area under consideration for creating a particular category of forest. And when once that is done, the state will take possession of it and declare it as the area for which it was to be named as either a reserve forest, village forest, or protected forest. In fact, the same pattern is followed also in the wildlife law. Now, what is a reserve forest? The three categories of forests which come within the realm of the government control. The first one is the reserve forest. It is by and large an exclusive government property. It can be any forest land or even a waste land which has been named as a reserve forest. And it is the usual procedure, as I was mentioning, under the land acquisition law, which leads to the proclamation and then complete freezing of rights, and ultimately, after the state takes control over that, extension of all rights in relation to that, any claims that anybody has would get settled, either compensation or any other kind of relief that's provided, and the state will have complete control over them. Normally, the idea behind creation of reserve forest during the British time, which continues even now, is the state should have the liberty of growing whichever kind of plantation that they would like to have there, primarily the major timber. To satisfy that requirement, this area is called. But it is not necessary that reserve forest will have only the major timber. It could be non-timber forest also. But the requirement is that through a declaration of the state, it should be categorized as a reserve forest. Now, distinguishing reserve forest from other kinds of forest is simply this, that it depends upon the different kinds of rights, entitlements and claims that are recognized in this area. It is a lease as far as reserve forest are concerned when it comes to any kind of access of any individual or community of people there within that forest area. The law lists about a number of activities which are prohibited within the reserve forest area. Nobody can enter the reserve forest without due authorization or permission. And those who are allowed, they do not have much of a right in relation to that reserve forest area except for some basic livelihood requirements of them, subject to the state authorizing it, the state agency, that is the forest department, authorizing such a kind of activity. There cannot be any permanent structure that has been created wherein one would actually stay there or anything like that. Nobody can stay within the reserve forest area other than the authorized people there, and in that plantations do come. So there are several do's and don'ts with regard to the forest. There cannot be the local community who are in the vicinity of it entering it as and when they want to. They need to obtain permits and permissions to get in there. This was under the exclusive control of the state all the while, and it's only the year 1980 the new law was made called the Forest Conservation Act, about which we'll be discussing it a little later, wherein the state has the power of de-reserving a reserve forest, of treating it as any other kind, so that the rigor of conservation, of protection of this from any kind of human element is reduced through a process of de-reservation. And for that, the state government will have to take the permission of the central government, and they need to give reasons as to why they are going to de-reserve it. And only upon the authorization by the center, the state can create this as a de-reserved forest area. More about that as we get into the particular part of our discussion. The second category of forest is what is referred to as a village forest. The lawmaker did not consider the forest as something which should be out of bounds for the common man. The lawmaker knew fully well that certain parts of the forest are very useful for meeting the livelihood requirements of the people, those who lived within and in the close vicinity of the forest area. And so some kind of an access, some kind of a provision needed to be made to accommodate and facilitate such a kind of livelihood interest of groups of people being met. And for that, one more category of forest was created, called as the village forest. Under this, a part of the reserve forest may be carved out by the state. This is under section 28 of the Indian Forest Act, by way of an assignment to the village community. So it's an assignment by the state to the village community. So the state would identify a particular community of people that, look, this area you can maintain, manage and derive benefits out of it exclusively for yourself, to meet your basic needs and requirements. That is what is referred to as a village forest area. Interestingly, there is a separate law, a separate provision under this law, which actually provides for joint management of the forest between the forest department and the village community. This is under section 80, we will see about that later. And this provision has never ever been invoked. But what the government has done is, it has not even made use of the village forest whereby assigning forest to the village community, but through the 1988 forest policy document, wherein a mandate was imposed upon the state to engage communities of people in forest management, and to give effect to that, a particular kind of a program was launched by the government of India called as the Joint Forest Management Program. And in this, the state can assign any part of the forest area to a hand-picked group of people from a village community to maintain, manage that patch of the forest land in the manner prescribed and determined by the forest department. And the benefits derived therefrom can be put to use by the village community themselves. But this is under direct supervision, control and authority of the forest department. So it has nothing to do with the village forest idea, but this is under a program called the JFM program, launched by Government of India in late 1990, a program which wanted to bring people into the mainstream of forest governance. The Joint Forest Management Program had its genesis in something that a very enterprising forester did a good experiment of using his discretionary power of involving local communities of people in an area called as Arabari in West Bengal. And through this experiment, the forest conservation effort was a major success, something that was done some 30 years back or so. The government thought it fit to replicate that template that was created in Arabari and transformed into a national program as JFM, whereby the local communities at the state level can be involved in managing patches of forest land. It did not create any right in any community. It was something that was more by way of a grant, and that grant so given by the state can be withdrawn any time for whatever reason that the forest department would deem fit to take it back. And so it was once again a concession. Nothing to do with the village forest idea or forests that are jointly managed between the forest department and the communities of people under a contractual arrangement between the two, as has been provided under section 80. So basically, the Joint Forest Management Program has its roots in the 1988 forest policy document, has no statutory backing, and some of the states over a period of time incorporated it in the rules that they made, and under the rules this program was made part of the law as well. Then you had a third category of forest called as the protected forest. The relevant provisions are mentioned on the slide here. It is, in terms of description, it is any forest land or wasteland which is not a reserve forest. That means any forest land other than reserve forest is a government property, and the government can declare this as a protected forest. But what are the markers in determining something as a protected forest? The only marker is that the state, either for any purpose of conservation or for facilitating certain kinds of plants, animals to get reared there, maybe during the breeding season or anything like that, for parts of those forest area which are known for that particular phenomenon, may be earmarked and called as a protected forest area. They are protected because human intervention would disrupt the natural process there. That is the only scientific reason, not explained in the act, but you have to borrow from science to really understand the idea of a protected forest. Not just that. There is a provision also for reserving trees. Certain trees which are considered to be very valuable and are of very great ecological and geomorphological significance and are an ecosystem by themselves, like the big banyan tree, can be reserved as a reserved tree, wherein it is a no-go area, no member of human community can meddle with it. It is under complete protection of the state forest department. So there can be protected forest, there can be protected trees as well, which are referred to as reserved trees. The state governments have the power of making rules with regard to the protected forest area. It's an interesting proposition that there is one full chapter under the Indian Forest Act, wherein the state not only exercises complete exclusive control over the forest that comes under the government property, it also exercises power even beyond the government forest property. And that has been very clearly identified in situations enlisted under one full chapter under this act. Number one, any land, it may be a forest land or it may be a private property which is not a forest area, but all of them are private properties which are very close to a forest area. In order to protect the forest that is under the exclusive control of the state can impose certain conditions on the kind of use of a private land that could be put into. Why should the state impose restrictions on use of my own private land? Because I have complete ownership over that. I can do whatever I want to do with that particular property. The reasoning behind this provision is that yes, you have the ownership. You have a right to use your property every way you like. But it is under subject to this particular limitation that your activity should not in any way affect the integrity of the forest in the neighborhood. Supposing yours is a low-lying area which is prone to flooding during the rainy season, then the state may say that, look, whatever flood that comes on your land, that's your lookout. How do you channelize? How do you allow it to run off? It's your lookout. But don't allow the water that has flooded your land to flood the forest area which is under our direct control. So you may have an embankment, you may have some kind of a construction to prevent such a kind of a spillover. Like that, the state can impose conditions on the use of a private land to protect the forest which is under the control of the state. This is one provision. The second one is that the state can prescribe conditions as to how you are going to manage your property so that your management and your use of your property will not harm the forest that's being managed by the forest department. But when such conditions are laid down, and if the owner expresses difficulty that, look, you have laid down conditions, I cannot manage the way that you have asked me to manage, then in that event, the state would actually manage that land for him. So it assumes the management of that land to fulfill the requirements of the rules that they have laid down for that particular purpose, while the ownership remains with the owner, the private owner, The management is taken over by the forest department. This is the second situation whereby the government can have control over private lands. The third situation is for a particular purpose, the state may require a private land to be put to use, maybe for a few months' time or a few years' period of time or anything like that. And after having taken control over that, as provided under this law, when it seeks to return that land, the owner may refuse to take it back. It's a temporary acquisition. And after temporary acquisition, the purpose is achieved. The state wants to return that land to him. And the owner says that you have already used this land. Now this has become useless for me, or I have lost interest in this particular land. You take it over. You expropriate this land. The state will have to take that land. There is no choice left for the state there. I, as the private owner, I don't want to have any more use of this land because you have effected certain changes in it, and now you are returning it with some compensation, of course, but that's inadequate for me. I am no longer interested in managing it, this subject to those conditions that you are laid down. Take over. That is the third situation. The fourth situation where the state can take absolute control over the property is not only expropriation, but it can also be done at the behest of the request to the owner that, look, I have a land which is close to the forest area managed by you. I have a fear that my management of this particular land, the manner in which you want me to use my land, will not be met with whatever resources, with whatever knowledge and skills that I have. Do one thing. All these conditions are acceptable to me, but I cannot manage. You manage it all the while for me. You protect it at my request. And for which, whatever the charges are, you can recover it from whatever overflow that comes from our land, and the rest of the money you can hand it over to me. So I am like an absentee landlord. My land is managed by you. You maintain and manage that. You use all the resources there. And from whatever that you get, the overflow, your administrative costs are met, and you return the excess, whatever that remains out of it. Well, this is a provision that has been made very significantly for a particular purpose. The government wanted to have more control over private lands, and this provided the device, means and mechanism for the state to exercise control over land which is not within the forest area or the government. So here is a very unique law, the forest law, which not only gives complete control over the forest area under the government as a government property, it can also give certain additional powers for the state and state agencies to exercise control over private lands to protect the forest. If you look to the subsequent provisions, quite a large number of provisions are devoted primarily for the purpose of regulating activities concerning timber, because timber is considered as a major forest produce. The new nomenclature that has been given to it is timber produce. So for growing timbers, forests are there. That is the idea when the British made this law. And that is the reason why they created a large number of provisions which deals with cutting of trees, seasoning them, transit of trees, the wood out of the forest area, the licensing system in that regard, the mode, method of cutting, seasoning, and then taking it to the market, the kind of inventory that has to be maintained, levying of a duty of use of that collection of the drift, the stranded timber, all these are provided in as many as 3-4 chapters under this law. It's about timber cutting, timber transit, timber which is drift, which is stranded, and which is confiscated, so there are penal provisions also, and which are put to auction and different kinds of uses by taking it to the marketplace and then later sale and all that. This has been a major part of the forest law. There are also provisions for penalties and procedures in relation to them. These include seizure and release of forest product, anything that is there in the forest, even when it is brought from outside the forest. Once it is found in the forest area, it is a state property. And anybody who is going to take it out of the forest area is guilty of a forest offense. And so there is provision for seizure. Criminal law provisions are here for confiscation. And if there are any grievances, within this law itself, there is a grievance redressal mechanism. There can be an appeal. The property is completely with the state. Punishments are there for violation of it. There can be not only monetary sanctions that could be imposed, even arrests could be made. There can be preventive action if the forest authority suspects somebody would, at a later point of time, would come and do the thieving activity. There is provision for trial. There is for provision for compounding of offences. There is an interesting provision with regard to what is called as cattle trespass. It has already been explained that no human being can transgress, interfere, enter into the forest without authorization. It becomes trespass of an individual, liable for penal action. But there is also a provision for what is called as cattle trespass. And here, the expression cattle does not mean cattle alone as we know in common parlance. It could be any animal. Any animal other than the human being. So an ant and an elephant, apart from the cow, can come under this category, which is not to be found in the forest area but was outside that. Getting in there is considered to be a punishable act. Supposing a cattle transgresses into the forest area, the cow herd accidentally allows the cattle to go in there, and the cow gives the cow dung there, leaves it there. Even to get the cattle out of the forest area, this guy need have to go to the forest officer with a request that these were unintentional and there is no desire of any trespass there. And to get the cow done, he will not get it. Because once it is found in the forest area, whether it is done by bringing something else into the forest area or that was very much there within the forest earlier, it becomes forest property of the government. That's a very interesting provision. Anything found in the forest is government property. So you have provisions with regard to the creation of different cadres of forest officers. And as I was mentioning earlier, there is a separate provision for joint forest management under Section 80. And what actually amounts to public purpose are mentioned here.